From the studios of Books in Motion in Spokane, Washington, this is Gene Engene reading Casca, God of Death by Barry Sadler. We'll begin with a prologue. Casca came to the Rhine at the same spot where he had fought his first battle against the German tribesmen known as the Suevii. The grass always seemed to be a little richer where blood had been spilled. In his mind, he could almost make out the outlines of the fight. A smaller patch of green 100 yards distant, where the young men of the cavalry unit assigned to Casca's unit had been pulled from their horses by long-hooked poles and had their throats slit with fish knives while they lay on the ground. That barbarian ambush had almost been successful. Only the legion's automatic response to danger in the immediate forming of the square had saved them all from being butchered and having their heads stuck on poles outside the longhouses of the barbaric tribesmen from across the Rhine. Casca walked slowly, memories rushing upon him. Stopping, he bent over and picked up a piece of metal protruding from the earth. It was the handle of a knife stuck in something. Tugging gently, Casca freed it. The rusty blade came forth, almost completely eaten away, but still strong enough to hold the piece of human skull it had penetrated so many years ago. Ours or theirs? Casca mused. He hooked his pack up higher and looked in the direction of the river. He walked toward it, his footsteps taking him back to that first battle when he was young, and the copper taste of piss-blinding fear was in his mouth. He knew that beneath his feet were the bones of men whom he had known and served with, some friends, some not, but all comrades. The Legion. The Legion. My only true home, my father and my mother. Here is where I killed my first man over 150 years ago. The wheel turns. As I told the leader of the caravan out of Anatolia before we headed for Damascus, the wheels of the gods grind slow, yet they grind exceedingly fine. Everything is as it was and will be. The only exception is me. I am what I was, and apparently always will be until the Jew comes again. I am the continuation of myself. Shit, where the hell did I learn to talk like that? Continuation my ass. I am what I am. Perhaps I get a little maudlin now and then, but life is still interesting. There are yet places to go, people to meet, women to love, and leave. Casca drew himself erect, his hand on his belt. He looked across the river. The Jew said it. What I am, that I shall be. Good enough. I am Casca, soldier of the legions, part-time slave. But I exist. Cogito ergo sum. I will beat the Jew yet. My fortunes lie in front of me. In life and adventure. Certainly I get feelings of sympathy for myself now and then, but, as he said, I am what I am. Therefore I shall live the life that my destiny demands, but as my own man. Absorbed in his interior monologue, Casca had reached the river. The Rhine, dark and swift, flowed before him. He knelt at the same spot where he had slaked his thirst in the then bloody waters of that battle so long ago. His battle thirst, after the Suevii had broken and run, and the legionnaires had slaughtered them all the way to the river and even in it. The passing face of a young German boy ran before Casca's eyes and faded. One he had killed? It grew hard to recall them all after a while. Casca sat by the bank of the great river, looking across to where no Roman in his right mind would want to be. Germania. Terra incognita. The unknown lands of the fiercest tribesmen on earth. The Germans and the Parthians were the only peoples to stand against the might of imperial Rome. But the Parthians were cultured and rich, with not only the heritage of the great Persian Empire, but with the sophistication of their first conquerors, the Greeks, under the young warrior Alexander. The Germans were something else. Casca had the feeling they would always be a pain in the ass to the rest of the world, no matter how civilized they might eventually become on the surface. They had, born in them, and nurtured by the first taste of their mother's milk, a lust for life that fulfilled itself only in battle. By all the demons of whatever reality there are, it seems as if the sage Xu Lao Tse was right. Everything is a great circle and repeats itself like that endless line of slaves in the mines of Greece, never ending, always coming back to the beginning. Or is it the end? Perhaps beginning and ending are both the same. The night was close upon him, and the water looked too damn cold for swimming across in the dark. Tomorrow is time enough. Building a small fire, Casca waited, letting the warmth of the red embers reach deep within him. The piece of donkey meat he was cooking crackled and sizzled. The rich smell of the roasting meat made his mouth salivate. In anticipation, he smacked his lips. Ha! Nothing like a nice hot piece of young ass to set a man's mouth watering. As the meat turned crisp and juicy, Casca reached over and cut off a slice and filled his mouth with the strong taste of young ass. He gulped the meat down, pulled his cloak around him, rolled over, and went to sleep facing the fire. Tomorrow, Germany. When the dawn came and Casca awoke, there was the same type fog rolling across the river as had surrounded the ghost-like images of the Suevi floating across the Rhine on logs so many years ago. But this time it was Casca's turn to enter the whirling waters. The coals of his fire had long since died. Grumbling as he rose, he walked to the water's edge, scratching his ass. He farted and joined his stream with that of the mighty river. Going back to his campsite, he stirred the dead coals hopefully and looked questioningly at a piece of the donkey flesh that remained, but it was now black and charred. Restraining a belch, he mumbled, "No way. There's no way I'm going to eat a piece of cold, burned ass this early in the morning." The ground fog swirled around him and the trees. The dawn became day. The rising sun burned off the mist, a few rays breaking through the surrounding trees to give a sense of impending warmth. "Well, shit," he said aloud, looking at the river. "I might as well get it over with. The sooner I get across, the sooner I can dry off." He dragged a log to the river's edge, tied his gear, a chunk of donkey meat, and his pack to it, and shoved off into the frigid dark waters. Gingerly at first as he waded in, cursing at the icy cold. "Whew! Ah! Damn, that's cold!" As the Rhine slowly advanced up his legs, his scrotum tried to climb up even higher to avoid the chilling advance, but as nature wills it, his balls could only go up so far. And then he was in, and the coldness became warm as he struck off and began paddling across, letting the current take him. It really didn't make a damn where he landed, so he let the river do the work. The waters finally took him to where his feet could touch bottom. Groaning, he pushed the log to the edge of the bank and began to take his gear from it before leaving the water himself.
"Ho, little man! What do you hear?"
The speaker, unexpected as he was, seemed to exemplify that popular image of German barbarism. He stood 6'3", and he was 250 pounds of meat-stuffed flesh if he was an ounce. He wore a horned helmet, and his sweeping mustache would have made a walrus proud.
"Oh, little man,"
he repeated, his voice the thundering bellow of an oversized Germanic ox.
"Do you come ashore? I can see that you are not of the tribes, so therefore you must pay before entering this land. As I am a reasonable man, I will take only your pack and weapons."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.